Let me just say some thank yous to Chrissy Hutchison-Jones, Justin Leahy, and Holly Fernandez-Lynch on my staff for putting this wonderful event together. Now, it's my privilege to get to introduce the interrogator-in-chief, Peter Hutt. Peter is a senior counsel at Covington, where he's been for, I think, all but 4 years of your career, Peter?
Yes.
Peter was, during those 4 years, general counsel at FDA. He's also the author of the leading casebook, the leading book, I think, period, on the FDA. And he's taught food and drug law at Harvard Law School for 23 years, including by teaching me. So, you know, he deserves applause just for having weathered that storm. But it's really my pleasure to introduce Peter, who's going to introduce our guest of honor. And the program for today will be a certain period of time for questions and answers between our two guests. And then we will have an audience participation period. We'll have you queue up to the microphones during that period. And remember to keep questions to be questions and to keep them relatively brief so we have time for answers. So with that said, let me introduce Peter Hutt.
Well, it is my great pleasure and indeed a great honor to introduce our guest, Peggy Hamburg. She knows this part of the world very well. She was an undergraduate at Radcliffe and then went to Harvard Medical School for her medical education. So she is Harvard through and through. After graduating and doing some work at NIH and in other places in Washington, she had the great experience from 1991 to 97 of being commissioner of the New York Department of Health and Mental Hygiene. So she saw public health from the ground up. From there, she went to be assistant secretary of the Department of Health and Human Services in Washington for policy and evaluation. So she saw public health from the top down. Now, having done both of those, she got right in the middle as Commissioner of Food and Drugs from 2009 to 2015, and just recently left that position. Peggy, tell me, having seen it from the bottom and seen it from the top, when you got to FDA, how did that influence your thinking?
Well, I think that my background and experience actually turned out to be highly, highly relevant to my leadership at FDA and enormously valuable to me. But I wouldn't have imagined that when I actually took on the job. When I first started discussing the FDA role, you know, I did it with some considerable trepidation. In fact, I think if you had encountered me 6 months before I'd actually begun to discuss the job with the Obama administration, I would have put down a large sum of money that nothing on earth would make me do that job, because I saw it as one of those jobs where the definition of success is basically that everyone is mad at you. But in fact, I think it really enabled me to bring both a strong sense of science and understanding science to the table, because I'd also done research at the NIH and at Rockefeller University at the bench in clinical research, an understanding of what it takes to implement a program on the ground and the importance of public health. And I'll add there, my experience in New York City really helped me to learn about the importance of public health law, and that law gave us the tools, using science as our guide, to implement the programs and policies necessary to promote and protect health. So that experience was just invaluable. Obviously, the experience of working at the federal level in government was very important, so that I wasn't just overwhelmed by what it meant to work in a bureaucracy and the different levels of government and the complex interactions between the White House, HHS, the agencies, and the Congress. And I think I also already had been exposed to some of the issues, because in that job in HHS as an assistant secretary, I had the opportunity to be involved in policy across all the domains of the Department of Health and Human Services, so I was familiar with the scope of FDA and some of its issues, but it wasn't until I was in place that I really understood the demands of the job, the huge vastness of the roles and responsibilities, and the really essential and unique role that FDA plays, not just in American life, but really around the world. And that was both very sobering, but also, you know, very invigorating, because I'll tell you, I've never had a job, and I don't expect to have another job, where every day I have this sense of mission about what I'm doing, that it really mattered in the lives of all of you, with the lives of every American. You know, from the time you get up in the morning to the time you go to bed, you are benefiting from FDA's work and benefiting from the hard work of the extraordinary people that work there.
Let me remind the audience of what Peggy is talking about. This is an agency that regulates 25% of every dollar that is spent by every American every day. It has a budget of roughly $4 billion and 12,000 employees.
15,000 now.
18?
15.
15, okay.
Not every, increased. That's FTEs, not every position is filled. But
well, it's a very large organization, and they aren't all located in Washington. They're located in every city in the United States. I'm sure many people don't realize, Peggy, that FDA regulates cell phones and microwave ovens and TVs, in addition to foods and drugs and cosmetics. But just looking at the vastness of that, how can you manage that? What kind of programs did you put in place, Peggy, to try to make sure that what that vast agency was doing was indeed in the public interest?
Yeah, well, you know, this was also very interesting to me. As a veteran of government, I came in, you know, really understanding that many of the areas I would focus on would be identified for me because of the nature of crises and what's happening in the larger environment. But also looking at the FDA, it was very clear to me that this was a critical moment in time to reposition it for the challenges of the 21st century. And this is a very old and distinguished regulatory authority. It was signed into law by Teddy Roosevelt back in 1906. And as Peter knows better than anyone, many of the important legal regulatory frameworks for the FDA were put in place decades ago. But in a world that's changing rapidly, both in terms of the science and technology that underlies the products that FDA regulates and the world of science and global commerce that FDA has to operate within, FDA really had to find some new ways of thinking and some new ways of doing things. And so I really focused on a couple of critical areas that, you know, were more or less defined by my early experience at the FDA. And really, I set three broad priorities. One was to try to open up the agency in terms of the understanding of public and policymakers. And I think it's fair to say, you might have your own perspective on this, but that I took the helm at FDA at a time when the agency was fairly embattled. There'd been a series of issues, mainly drug safety-related issues, that had put FDA very much in the public eye with a lot of media bashing and congressional hearings and other things. And the morale at FDA was low. They sort of circled the wagons, not wanting to stick their heads out too much for fear they might get their heads cut off. And I would say that public trust and confidence in FDA had been eroded a bit. So I did feel it was very important to engage and try to both enhance morale within FDA and open us up more in terms of hoping to convey more information to all of our stakeholders about what we do, how we do it, and why, but also to engage more with stakeholders who have to, especially in the modern era, be true partners. FDA really can't have a model of sort of sitting on the hill and waiting for issues to come to FDA or waiting for a drug application to cross the threshold. There really needs to be a much more integrated approach. So that was one priority. The second was to strengthen science within the walls of FDA in terms of the scientists and the ability to do quality science, and also, again, to engage with the broader scientific community, because in an increasingly complex world, being able to have the scientific expertise to address the issues coming before us was absolutely essential. And I think that science had not been as supported in the preceding period. There'd been an important study of the Science Board that had called attention to that just before I took office. And that enabled me to make some significant progress in that domain. And I focused a lot of attention on the need to develop and really establish as a legitimate component of the scientific enterprise what I called regulatory science, which is really the knowledge and the tools that's necessary to assess safety, efficacy, quality, and performance, which is the task that is given to the FDA. But in order to do that, it really requires advancing scientific knowledge and crucially has to be linked into the whole process, the continuum that is research and development. And I think that's been very important as well. And the third area you touched on, which is responding to the challenges of globalization. And I just about fell out of my chair when I learned what globalization meant for the FDA, that 40% of finished drugs, about 80% of the active pharmaceutical ingredients in the drugs that we use are manufactured outside of the US borders. About 50% of medical devices are made elsewhere. About 50% of fresh produce and fruit and nuts are coming from overseas, and about 85% of seafood. So, you know, FDA could not really follow the model that was part of the original vision of FDA of inspecting products as they come over the border, products who were being produced in whole or in part from 120 plus countries around the world, coming in through some 300 plus ports of entry, water, trucks, trains, planes. And we really needed to think about how we were going to deal with this. We needed to push out our presence to places around the world, and we really had to create new working relationships with regulatory authorities around the world and with the often multinational industries that we regulated, but also the industries based in other countries, so that we could assure that the products that Americans were consuming met our standards for safety, quality, and efficacy.
Now, to address these three priorities, you had to really negotiate with the Washington establishment. You had the White House, the Office of Management and Budget, which obviously is of crucial importance, but also the secretary of your own department, the Federal Trade Commission, the Environmental Protection Agency. I'm sure you spent time with your old friends at NIH. And then there's that group up on a hill called Congress. How did you manage all that? What amount of your time was involved in really the daily politics of Washington, as well as running the agency itself?
Yeah. Well, it is a huge challenge, and it requires a lot of care and feeding all of those relationships. And you know, the personal relationships really do matter. I found that it was very, very useful early on to spend a lot of time in meetings and really sort of listening sessions with all of our different stakeholders and making the rounds on the Hill with critical members of Congress, both so they would get to know me and, you know, where I felt that progress needed to be made, but most importantly, so I could hear them and their concerns. And I really learned a lot and really shaped a lot of programs and policies based on what I was hearing, you know, the need for more transparency and clarity and predictability in what we did, the need for more partnership. I was really pleased that over the time that I was at FDA, not only were we the agency in a set of Gallup polls that are done every couple of years looking at public confidence in the agency, that we were the agency that increased the most during my tenure. But when I started, we were just above the IRS. So, you know, I don't know. They went down and we went up. But in any case, but, you know, another measure of success in building those relationships, I think, was that, number one, every year we got a budget increase, which is vitally important. And FDA, to this day, is just grotesquely under-resourced for its set of responsibilities and its unique and essential role in health of individuals and populations, but also in the economy. But, you know, budget really mattered, and I fought for that. Sometimes broke the rules about not ever saying that the president's budget was enough. But also, a set of important pieces of legislation were passed during this almost 6 years that I was commissioner that really gave us new authorities and tools to do our job more effectively on the food safety side with the Food Safety Modernization Act, and on the drug side with FDASIA, which gave us new authorities to work more effectively on the global scene, as well as you know, really helped to establish some more streamlined regulatory pathways and models that would bring in stakeholders in new ways. And then, of course, the tobacco legislation, which gave FDA the authority for the first time to regulate tobacco products. And, you know, the dirty little secret is that tobacco remains the leading cause of preventable death in this country and around the world. So the ability to really bring the FDA into the public health regulation and oversight of tobacco products, I think, is enormously important.
Of course, one of the great hazards of being the commissioner is that you wake up one morning and find there's a worldwide crisis and you're right in the middle of it now. You went through that with Ebola. I noticed the World Health Organization announced 2 days ago, that's all over now.
And then there was immediately another case, I regret
yes.
to say.
Yeah. So how, describe to us what you suddenly found
yeah.
yourself in with that matter.
Well, you know, there was just a cycle of crises, big and small, real and imagined, that drove activities. And I think, you know, part of my role as commissioner was to try to deal with those issues and protect the others at the FDA so they could do their important work. You know, it certainly was my experience that, you know, you could wake up in the morning and read the newspaper and one bad headline, you know, could completely derail your plans for the day. And sometimes it was a pseudo crisis and a PR issue that had upset someone in the White House or on Capitol Hill. But sometimes it was a genuine crisis. And sometimes it was a crisis where FDA had an essential role to play and, you know, an immediate need to step up to the plate. Sometimes it was a crisis we were already involved in, but new dimensions were revealed or new information gained. You know, sometimes there were things where I really didn't feel that it was, the burden was on FDA. But, you know, one of the challenges is you can't just say this isn't our problem when people's lives are at stake or their serious public health risk. So navigating all that, you know, was very, very challenging. And it required a lot of flexibility and resilience, a thick skin for sure. And I think one of the skills you'd asked earlier about how my other experiences have had affected me at FDA, I think one of the skills I had learned earlier on, particularly when I was commissioner in New York City, was that you know, I think I was better at detecting what were the real crises from, you know, what were the you know, sort of more public relations crises. But you know, one of the things that kept me up at night was that there are so many things to worry about, so many mm-hmm. things that can go wrong. As I said, FDA is dramatically under-resourced, and I never felt that we had all of the tools we needed, the people, the dollar resources, the laboratories, et cetera, to fully and adequately do our job.
Well, let me ask you about the kind of thing that also springs out from Congress. You mentioned tobacco and the new Food Safety Modernization Act. But you also suddenly found yourself with authority for the first time to approve new biological products that are follow-on products mm-hmm. from existing products. And there you're right in between two major interests. The people defending the existing products and not wanting competition, and the generic drug industry wanting to bring new products mm-hmm. and new competition. How do you navigate between those, the yeah. rock and the hard place?
Well, what we're discussing here is what's called biosimilars, which yes. is sort of the generics for complex biological products. And as some of you may know, increasingly the really important therapeutic strategies now are using biologicals, and they're having a huge impact on treatment of disease, even cure, but they are very expensive. And they're much harder to develop and manufacture than a chemical drug. So everybody, especially in the midst of recovery from an economic crisis, could see huge cost savings from the rapid introduction of biosimilars. But there also was a real concern about, are these biosimilars in fact similar enough that they will adequately treat the patient, that they won't create new safety issues or quality concerns. And so there was a lot of heated debate, a lot of pressure about how much exclusivity biosimilars, the innovator biologic should get, and at what stage biosimilars could be introduced. A lot of issues even around how to name biosimilars, because it was felt that the names were too distinctive, that it might reduce their uptake as generics. So lots of heated discussions with people with different perspectives and agendas. FDA does have, and I'll call it a luxury, of not actually being able to weigh in on pricing issues. It's interesting because most people assume that part of the FDA approval process is a cost effectiveness, but it really is not. And in fact, I believe it's prohibited by the law for FDA to weigh in on the pricing. So we steered clear of some of the most contentious debates on the Hill and in policy circles on the pricing and the exclusivity issues. And we focused our attention on trying to develop the program, the regulatory pathways, the guidances for industry, and the determinations about how to establish safety and efficacy and similarity, including interchangeability of the biosimilars, which is no small task.
One of the issues that the public is most familiar with is the approval of new drugs. Then FDA is always judged by how it does on that. A few months ago, there was this remarkable article in Forbes magazine, and the title, I wrote it down, FDA is basically approving everything.
I can tell you industry doesn't feel that way.
But the statistics that he gave in that article were absolutely accurate. In 2015, there was an 89% approval rate on new drugs as of the time that he wrote that article. He had, I think, the reasons wrong. He said it was politics. You and I would agree that had nothing to do with it. He also said FDA was approving unsafe and ineffective drugs. That wasn't it. I believe it's the greater transparency of the agency so that industry is able to understand what the requirements are and therefore able to meet those requirements.
Well, and it's also, I agree with you, and actually the author of that article, I think, kind of regrets it. I have spoken to him and he realizes that he you know, framed things, you know, in a way that wasn't completely to the point, although I can't speak for him. But I agree with what you just said. I think it also reflects the fact that the actual applications that come to the FDA today are stronger than they were before.
Yes.
A lot of stuff, the majority of products that start out on the research and development pathway fail. But many of those products would come to the FDA for review and they wouldn't get approved. I think one of the things that's happened in recent years is that there's much more engagement early on in the R&D process.
Yeah.
So the right studies get done, the right questions get asked, and of course the science is advancing. When you understand the underlying mechanism of a disease and identify the right targets for treatment, the assessment of does it work is much more rapid. And as we've learned more about predictive toxicology and other ways of assessing safety, you can also weed out the things that are going to fail earlier on. And so the goal is to have fewer things actually come into the review process, and the things that come into the review process being the things that are based on really sound science and reflecting, you know, really elegant studies that address the kinds of issues and questions that the FDA will need answers for. So I think the process has gotten more streamlined, more science-based, mm-hmm. and the science and products have gotten better. We still have a ways to go. The other thing that happened, and again, linking the work of the FDA to legal authorities that make a difference, is that FDA was given more authority now quite a while ago to also have very proactive oversight of the post-market period with resources to do that. And so this ability to actually have ongoing assessment of the product in the marketplace actually also, I think, enables the approval process to happen in a somewhat different way. We have, you would think I would never forget some of this, but I can't remember the exact terminology. I think it's conditional approval, but I'm not sure.
Accelerated approval.
Thank you. It's good to have a lawyer around. Where, you know, based on a certain level of evidence, something can be approved for broader use in the marketplace, but additional studies have to be done and ongoing assessment, and that approval can be taken away. And actually, one of the more controversial decisions that I had to make while at FDA had to do with a drug where it had gotten accelerated approval, and then based on the follow-up studies, the efficacy, it was a cancer drug for metastatic breast cancer, and the extended survival wasn't demonstrated, and some significant safety issues were really documented, and so the approval for that use was actually taken away. The company contested that, and the law required that the FDA commissioner actually review the data and the studies and make the final approval. And that is rare. You know, I thought when I took the FDA job that, you know, one of the great demands was that every day I was going to have to be reviewing these huge portfolios of drug applications and, you know, signing off. But most of the decisions are actually made at a much lower level. And so, you know, this was one of the rare instances where the FDA commissioner actually had to make the final decision.
Peggy, let me follow up on the accelerated approval provision, because that's extremely important. Actually, that was invented by FDA by regulation, and then Congress wrote it into law. It was not widely used at all. In 2009, there was an article written by a good friend of mine, Gardner Harris, I'm sure.
Yes, a good friend of mine.
Yes, also yours. He was in college with my daughter.
Is that right?
That's how I got to know him. But Gardner pointed out that the regulation of cancer drugs was very, very negative. And the article said there's, in regulating cancer drugs, the answer is always no. He was referring to the director of the Office of Oncology at that time. This January, this very January, Gardner Harris wrote a second article saying that now the same individual in FDA, because he had lost his wife to cancer, was using accelerated approval the way Congress intended. Why can't we get all the division directors in the office in CDER, the Center for Drugs, why can't we get them to learn from Rick Pazdur and turn around and get these drugs out faster?
Yeah. Well, a couple things. One, you know, Rick Pazdur is an extraordinary human being, and, you know, the loss of his wife, you know, was absolutely tragic. She was an oncology nurse herself at NIH, and, you know, when you have that kind of experience, it certainly does deepen your perspective on the importance of access to medical products that can make a difference. He had already started, before she was diagnosed, to make very significant progress in terms of rethinking some of the models. And again, it comes back to both being willing to think in new ways and take some risks, but also understanding the science and the advance of the science. And, you know, the field of oncology has transformed dramatically because of the ability to really understand the underlying nature of the tumors and the immune response of individuals to tumors, the recognition that, in fact, the way we used to think about cancer isn't even accurate, that not all, you know, that you can't just think about it as a body part disease. It's more, what does the tumor look like? And treatments in one type of cancer actually prove very valuable in another type of cancer where you would never have thought about it, because, in fact, the nature of the tumor pathology is similar. So, you know, we've been able to make huge gains both applying new knowledge to different areas of therapy, but also in terms of developing more targeted treatments, understanding which treatments will work for whom. But it has come about in part because the science and the understanding of disease has advanced, but also the willingness to look at new, more innovative models for clinical trials that enable you to get robust scientific answers, but more quickly and in a more streamlined way, and to really target therapies in the ways that will ultimately prove the most beneficial. I think that what Rick has done in that division has really shown a light on the importance of the work and provided a blueprint for others to follow. But it isn't directly transferable because the science is in different places. You know, I frequently am saddened by the fact that people say, look at what's happening in cancer. You know, why are you so rigid in neurodegenerative diseases? You know, people desperately need Alzheimer's treatments, and you're not approving anything, or not very much. But it's not because the reviewers and the scientists in that arena are rigid and adhering to backwards or unenlightened approaches to regulatory review, it's because the science isn't there, the products aren't there. We don't understand what even is the disease model adequately to be developing some of the products that are so vitally needed. We don't have the biomarkers to speed clinical trials. We don't have the diagnostics that we'd like to even be able to identify who needs treatment and who doesn't. So, you know, you also have to think about where we are in terms of where the science is. And we've certainly made the most progress in the area of oncology and also some areas of infectious diseases, including HIV/AIDS.
Let me switch for a moment to a subject that some of the lawyers in the room will be uniquely interested in, and that is the right to free speech under the First Amendment. For years, that was not applied to FDA in any way at all. And now we're seeing major changes, major court opinions. And I'll focus on just one, and that is on the doctrine that FDA has espoused, even I actually created it at the beginning, that a company could not promote an approved drug for an unapproved use, even though a physician could prescribe an approved drug for an unapproved use. What the courts are beginning to say is that doesn't make sense under the First Amendment. Is FDA planning ahead for trying to figure out how to conform its doctrine to comply with the First Amendment rather than leaving it up for the courts to decide that? Because this is of vital importance to the health of the country.
Well, I think you know I can't speak for what the FDA is planning at this point and thinking about, but I can tell you that when I was there, it was a topic of some considerable attention and focus. And recognition that we needed to, again, think in some new ways about how best to serve the American people, preferring not to have this played out in the courts and decisions made in the courts, but really working with stakeholders to figure out what are the correct pathways. I think, you know, probably all of you understand that the FDA doesn't regulate the practice of medicine. And as you said, you know, many drugs are used to great effect, positive effect, off-label in medical practice. I think we live in an information era where we all have an obligation to better understand the data and evidence for when is a drug indicated for use, whether on-label or off-label. And you know, one of the things that I think will be happening more and more are really good evaluations of the experience with off-label use to provide important information for practitioners and potentially for regulators. You know, one of the challenges with off-label use is that once your product is approved for one indication, it's unlikely, if you're a company, going to be in your company's interest to actually do the studies to demonstrate its use for another indication. Sometimes it is worth it, but often it's not, and it's used in practice, and there are published articles that inform healthcare providers about its use, and there's word of mouth, and there's experience, but there's always been that limit on companies actually promoting their product for those off-label uses. One of the issues that emerged while I was at the FDA that was of concern was that there was a challenging situation that would emerge where industry scientists might be at a scientific conference. The topic of an off-label use and the studies to support it might be a topic of discussion. You might be on a panel. Everybody else could talk about those studies, but you, the industry scientist, couldn't weigh in because it might be perceived as lobbying for the youth, whatever. And you might, in fact, have really important knowledge to bring to bear on this discussion. And so, you know, one of the arenas that we started working on was how to address that concern and really support robust scientific discussion about this. Also, you know, trying to look at how to use existing data and experience to inform knowledge about safety and efficacy of drugs and off-label use. And I hope that work will continue to go forward. I think the question of whether this should all be open territory is a really challenging one. And I immediately see us going back in time to an era when, you know, the slickest promoters with not good products might have the loudest and most persuasive voices in the marketplace, and I think that won't serve the public well, and we don't want to create an environment where some kind of rigorous assessment of safety and efficacy isn't brought into the debate about a product. You know, I see sort of a descent to the bottom.
I don't think that will happen for one reason. The First Amendment does not protect misleading speech. And so FDA can always, at bottom, prevent that from happening. Right.
But it may happen after people have been harmed. That's a concern.
Always possible. Yeah. We'll have to guard against that. Let me just say to the audience that if you have a question, I'm about to ask another, you might want to come up to the microphone. But Peggy, while people are doing that, there's one other issue that I just wanted to give you a chance to talk about, and that is genetically modified food. We have an enormous controversy in the country. FDA has stated its position that it is safe, or you wouldn't allow it on the market. And yet, people want to know and be able to distinguish between GMO food and non-GMO. Do you have any comment on how FDA has faced that issue?
Yeah. Well, it's a complex issue, and it's an area, as you well know, where people's values become very important. And in Europe, you know, GMOs, in fact, are not allowed in the marketplace, even though their food safety agency has done a report, you know, speaking to safety of those products. But I think that, as I understood it, and you know the law so much better than I, but that the way FDA over many decades interpreted the law, and I think reinforced by important court decisions, was that if there was a material change in the product, either in terms of its safety or how it behaved, then that would have to be labeled. So, you know, certainly if it was genetically modified and there was some kind of a peanut element introduced into a product that normally wouldn't have peanuts, and you had an allergy to peanuts, that would be important information from a safety perspective, and it would have to be labeled that this product could expose you to peanut toxins if you're allergic, or if it behaved differently in terms of just the qualities of an oil and how it behaves when heated, whatever, that would have to be labeled also. But that if there was not a material change, then labeling was not indicated. We certainly supported companies to label products non-GMO if they chose to. And there was a guidance, I think, recently put out, proposed or final, I can't remember, that had to do with plants and GMOs. There now is a product in the marketplace, or it's not in the marketplace, but it's been approved, which is a genetically engineered salmon. And, you know, that's a whole different set of issues. But that's sort of where things, you know, currently stand. It's a complex set of issues, and you know, like everything at the FDA, my view was let's have the data and the science drive decision making, and there have been a lot of ongoing study about genetically engineered products. We actually were also trained to say genetically engineered, not genetically modified, because there is, you know, a technical difference. There's a lot of genetic modification that has gone on for centuries, but we're really talking about genetically engineered.
Yes. Shall we turn, and we'll give Glenn the honor of being the first question.
So I wanted to ask about some breakthrough technologies of the last year, in particular mitochondrial replacement therapy and CRISPR germline editing, gene editing. So both of these in other countries.
Sorry, I missed the first one.
So mitochondrial replacement therapy,
yeah.
So in other countries, especially in Europe, these technologies have not primarily gone to the regulator of devices and drugs. They've gone to an agency that has specialization in this, or they've gone to Parliament and the like. I'm curious whether you feel that in the ecosystem of federal agencies governing health, whether FDA is a good fit for these kinds of technologies, or whether you think that there might be another agency that might be a better fit, and how FDA kind of views these things, which are a little different than its traditional bailiwick.
Well, I think that obviously, you know, these new technologies require a lot of assessment and represent exciting opportunities to address disease, but raise some broader issues, ethics, social values, practicality, and other things. I don't think that in other countries necessarily they wouldn't be part of a regulatory schema at some point, but it's that there are other entities involved in the decision making as well. For example, the mitochondrial disease issue came to FDA because of the issue of was the technology ready to be actually studied in human clinical trials, and that required FDA to get involved. But there was also a determination that FDA should not be the arbiter of some of the ethical questions that were being raised, and so FDA, in discussions with other components of government, asked what was then the IOM, the Institute of Medicine, now the National Academy of Medicine, to look at that question. They're doing a study. Congress could decide to take it up also, just like the British Parliament took it up. But I think that you know, they are medical interventions. I think that they should be in the orbit of FDA oversight, but I don't think that FDA should be the only agency that addresses some of these issues, and I suspect that my European colleagues would say the same. On the CRISPR-Cas9 technology, which is, you know, a really extraordinary new approach with broad application in terms of gene editing, there was just a major conference that was international at the National Academy of Sciences to look at human gene editing, particularly germline, because this technology gives you the opportunity to affect the germline and essentially human evolution in ways that are rather novel. And there really was a sense that this needs to be done in a way that engages many countries around the world, that this, you know, really does require, just as Asilomar happened at the beginning of the recombinant DNA experience, the scientists actually said, we see the power and excitement of this new tool, but we also recognize that it has huge implications for life as we know it, and we want to have a broader conversation. And again, there are some ongoing studies in this country and others about that. Others have great concern about the CRISPR-Cas9 technology in terms of the ability to actually create new microorganisms that could be deliberately used to do harm. And in, you know, the world we live in, the possibility of that kind of weaponization is not completely unrealistic. And so that's another arena that's being looked at in terms of should there be special controls or oversight. But it's very hard. And, you know, like with many technologies, you have to find a way to enable the positive benefits to go forward, but recognize that there are opportunities for misapplication and try to figure out if there are ways to reduce those probabilities or possibilities. So I think this is going to be an ongoing national and international discussion.
You, sir.
Yes, Tom Morgan, speaking as a private citizen. I have to press a little harder on the First Amendment question, because you mentioned sort of a scenario where a scientist feels uncomfortable on stage. But what we're talking about here is someone working for a pharmaceutical company who makes a truthful statement that is not misleading, that is publicly known, and the federal government, the Justice Department, the FDA, taking that person, sending people with guns to get that person, handcuffing them, putting them in a cage, convicting them, only to have a judge overturn that conviction and tell the FDA not to do it, but the FDA continuing to assert that. Can you explain to the law students why that's a good policy for government?
Well, I've never heard that scenario described.
Amarin Pharmaceuticals will reference all of that, New York Times, Washington Post, et cetera.
Well, I think that the issue that I care most about is making sure that the American public can get accurate information. And I think that, again, you know, one can easily imagine instances where important information might not get to people, and we want to find ways to avoid that. But I think you don't want to create a system that will encourage bad products to be promoted that won't benefit people, may actively harm them, or may lead them to use a product with no benefit when there are existing products with benefit. And so I think that this is an ongoing discussion. And I think that the old system needs modification. As I said, you know, we were working on ways to address some of those concerns, not as fast as many would have liked. And you know, the courts are involved in the Amarin case and in other cases. And so I think that decisions will be unfolding. But I take your point about not wanting to limit access to therapeutics that may have benefit, not wanting to limit scientists from being able to talk about information that they have. But I also don't want a world in which snake oil salesmen can say anything they want about a product and the American people not having any ability to assess.
That's well. The objective. I think yeah. She has answered that. Peggy, you'll be interested to meet Rachel Sachs. She's a recent graduate of the law school preparing to go into academia.
Excellent. This has suddenly become a much more loaded question now. Okay, so Rachel Sachs with the Petrie Flom Center. This is fascinating. I wanted to ask about something which didn't come up, which is user fee amendments and mm-hmm. all their various forms. You know, it seems like on the one hand they're terrific support for an underfunded agency and they provide opportunities for constant rethinking about the approvals process. But on another hand, you know, on the other hand, we might worry about the injection of interest groups and Congress on a regular basis, and the amount of political capital you must have to spend is substantial. So I wanted to hear your thoughts from inside on how that process works and what you think of it.
Well, just for those who don't know, some of the FDA budget comes through what are called user fees, which are dollars from industry to support a set of programs and activities that are negotiated on a five-year basis. And the user fee agreement is carefully worked out with lots of firewalls to protect against undue influence, but also lots of performance measures and accountability that FDA does what it has agreed to do, and Congress approves the user fee agreement, and it becomes a vehicle for other regulatory reform or legislation. Sort of, it's must-pass legislation, basically, and so it can become a Christmas tree for other activities and ornamentation as well. When I first arrived at FDA, you know, I wasn't very familiar with the user fee program, and I was actually, you know, a little bit surprised by the growing influence of industry dollars in the overall FDA budget. On the other hand, when I looked at the FDA budget, I could see that without that, you know, the agency would be crippled in many ways. When you take away the user fees and you just look at what, you know, sort of basically are the budget authority dollars, the government dollars for FDA, it works out that every American pays about $8 a year, I think it is, for FDA services. And, you know, it surprises me that it's not I mean, the FDA budget should be bigger, and we're worth more than that, I think. I mean, probably by this moment in time, all of you have consumed more than $8 worth of FDA-regulated products. But people that, and you would know, I think, a lot about this because you were probably there before user fees were instituted.
Yes.
But it has made a huge difference in terms of the ability of FDA to clear backlogs, and really streamline review procedures to provide more guidance to industry, which is important as they deal with us, to be able to hire more scientists and do important work within FDA to advance knowledge and our activities. So, I think that all the people that have been part of this program over time say it has dramatically improved the quality of work and in some ways the transparency of work at the FDA, but I certainly understand the concern. You know, I haven't looked in a systematic way, but FDA is not unique around the world in terms of regulatory authorities that use user fees, and many regulatory authorities are almost wholly supported by user fees. I think we sort of have the right balance because I think that what FDA does is, in fact, a public good and there should be government dollars. And it's also clearly a benefit for the industry that's paying those user fees. It is not as though just because industry is paying FDA dollars, they get the answers that they want. Just as you pay a fee to get your driver's license, and I know from personal experience, although not mine, but a child, that you don't automatically get your driver's license either.
This gentleman to the left.
Hi, I'm John Helfrich from MIT. I'm working on food safety. If you had all the leaders of the food industry in this room and you could make one request to them about food safety, what would that be?
Well, I hate questions where there's only one.
I was just being polite. however many you'd like them.
Well, I think that what is going on in terms of the Food Safety Modernization Act and its implementation is really important, both conceptually and hopefully as it gets implemented in terms of results on the ground. But I think, you know, all companies have a responsibility to really understand their processes and their food chains and where problems are most likely to arise and have systems that reduce the likelihood that those problems will arise. You know, certainly it was striking to me when I first came to FDA how reactive we were. You know, there had to be a certain volume of cases before we would even recognize that an outbreak was going on, and then the complexity of trying to understand where that outbreak was occurring would add more time. Meanwhile, people might be exposed to contaminated or risky products. And, you know, so I think, you know, companies are the first line of defense, and they have the obligation to understand these risks and address them at the front end. I think we're entering a period where, again, advances in science can bring new and technology, new, better systems. But you know, some of the ways of doing things have been way too reactive, and I think we can prevent problems at the get-go.
Yes, sir.
First of all, I want to thank you for allowing this extraordinary and very informative exchange. I'm Laurent Adamowicz, the founder of a new foundation called ECHO, Eradicate Childhood Obesity. I've been a fellow here. And trying to promote a petition to Congress for a front label act. Specifically, I want to talk about a category that we didn't talk at all about today, baby formula. There are no USDA guidelines for baby formula because it falls completely under the FDA's responsibility, including its labeling. Yet, how do you explain that for young parents trying to understand that foodscape, so to speak, there is no mention of sugar. There's no mention of, like a food label would, the total sugar or the added sugar in that baby formula that happens to be loaded with it and creates the addiction for the baby, just like moving to toddler food and then soda and then on and on to an epidemic. How is that possible?
Well, a couple things. One, I may turn to Peter because I don't know for sure what the rules are, but we did take some actions about fraudulent claims on infant formula, as I recall. So I'm not sure what the framework is.
I think what you're questioning is why doesn't the nutrition facts label appear on infant formula? Is that what you're asking?
Yes, there are, in a sense, yes, and thank you, Peter, for correcting me and clarifying this. There are some partial nutrition facts. There is a list of ingredients people wouldn't understand. You know, what is corn maltodextrin or oligosaccharide? Mm-hmm. All these would normally be labeled as a, not mm-hmm. just total carbs, but total sugar content. Mm-hmm. There is none on baby formula. And legislation does not require it currently. Mm-hmm. And I find this shocking, and I don't understand why.
And infant formula is one of the areas where the predominant law that regulates it is quite old. And you know, on the one hand, that proved beneficial in that part of the old law was to prohibit importation, and that turned out to save lives of American infants because the scandal that happened in China with adulterated infant formula didn't reach here because of that. But it was a topic of discussion while I was at the FDA about the need to update some of those laws. And I think your observations underscore that there are many reasons why that matters. But I can't explain to you why historically that hasn't happened. And you know, it's one of many things at the FDA that needs attention. And you know, where I think that FDA needs more support for its work because things get prioritized, and sometimes the prioritization may not reflect all of the critical things that need to be done and done in a more timely way.
So if I hear you correctly, you're saying under your administration, you didn't have a specific group working on this, or you didn't have the resources
to
have it?
Well, we had a small number, but it was a small number, and as I said, I do recall, although I don't remember the details, about some actions taken about fraudulent claims. There was also some piece of regulation that took a long time to passage through. It had been, I think, several decades, but that did go forward while I was there. But it's not an area that I have, you know, deep expertise on, as is clear. And that I mainly was addressing it in terms of fraudulent claims and this issue of making sure that infant formula was protected from intentional or deliberate adulteration.
I think that really what you need to do is work with FDA to make this a priority so that the position you're taking would reach high enough up in the agency to be addressed.
Yeah. It's clearly our goal, thank you, and all the help we can get on that, thank you.
I'll put in a plug, although she's from Yale, but we have a FDA has a terrific new director of the Center for Food Safety and Applied Nutrition, Dr. Susan Main, and I'm sure that you would be, you know, interested in your...
I will. Thank you.
On the left here.
There may be other reasons for the very high product approval rating that FDA has had recently. Some outside observers have suggested that one of the hallmarks of your tenor there was that you relax safeguards against conflict of interest. It appears that many of the people that appointed experts to these advisory panels at FDA have very close links on advisory panels to industry and agribusiness or big pharma, and many of them receive their funding for a lot of their research from these sources. Do you really think you did enough to guard against conflict of interest for the public and the outside interests of many of the advisors that you appointed? Is it really that hard to find advisors that don't have those kinds of links?
Well, we did take conflict of interest very seriously and you know, had a clearly defined set of rules and requirements for conflict of interest, some set outside of the FDA and some specific to the FDA. But it is an ongoing challenge in terms of making sure that you have the right experts. Some of those experts may have worked on products that are related to the product under review or had other industry consulting. I think transparency about those conflicts does help. Many people that would have probably been able to provide important subject matter expertise were excluded from advisory committees because of conflicts. As passionately as you feel about the fact that you would have liked some of those experts not involved, you know, there also are people very concerned on the other side about whether we were, I heard equally that we were too rigorous about conflict of interest and the exclusion of people from advisory committees, but it's a really important area, and I think that there has been an ongoing examination of how best to deal with this, whether it's on FDA advisory committees, on publications in journals, National Academy of Medicine committees, et cetera. Everybody is grappling with this question of conflict of interest. But I think that FDA, you know, had a rigorous process, took it very seriously, tried to be as transparent as possible about it. And you know, I think that your perspective on it is welcome and you're not alone. But I think that if you really look at the membership of the advisory committees, it is the case that they adhered to a set of explicit and transparent criteria.
And it's also important to emphasize that whatever the advisory committee says and recommends is nothing other than a recommendation. The decision is with the FDA employees, none of whom have a conflict of interest.
Not at that time, but they may be going in the other direction later on.
Steve Helfer, Cambridge Citizens for Smokers' Rights. It's my understanding that the FDA is demanding that American Spirit Tobacco Company stop labeling its product as additive-free, even though the FDA does not dispute the accurateness of this statement. A two-part question. Number one, doesn't this pose serious First Amendment and informational ideas for the American public? And two, are you aware of any study on tobacco, additive-free tobacco?
You know, I apologize. I can't speak to that issue. I'm not up to speed on it, and I don't know what.
Yeah, I think it came after your tenure.
Yeah.
Thank you.
You, sir.
Oh, thank you. I really appreciate to have the opportunity to hear your magnificent speeches here in Harvard Law School. I'm a visiting professor of medicine from China. Now I'm spend my sabbatical in Harvard Medical School. Actually, in the 1990s and the early 20s, I was a medicinal chemist doing process research and development and help to industrialize some of the API. Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Mac should know that. Active pharmaceutical ingredient for the...
Do you have a question,
yes,
sir?
Sorry, angiotensin converting enzyme inhibitors for the treatment of heart, the hypertension and heart failure. So we all know now the China Food and Drug Administration is now upgrading its enforcement of regulatory measures on drug safety and the drug quality. And also, as you have said, globalization is one of your priority. Yes, and I have heard the FDA inspectors in China has increased from 4 person to maybe 260 persons. So my question is, how do you think the US FDA can work with the Chinese counterpart to improve the health for both the Chinese, American, and the world population?
Well, an important question, and FDA now does have an office in China and is very actively engaged working with CFDA and also the agency that oversees food safety, is it AQSIP? In any case, we have found it to be a productive working relationship, and CFDA, the Chinese FDA, as you probably know, is relatively new, and they are, you know, really trying to expand and establish themselves. There's been a lot of work on modernization and implementation of new food and drug laws in China. And we've, you know, tried to provide our perspective and experience as they have worked on that, both we saying when I was at FDA, but also more broadly. I know that some people from various academic institutions here have been involved in those activities as well. FDA certainly did not have 250 inspectors on a daily basis in China. The offices are small. It is one of the additional, you know, new expenses for FDA is having offices around the world and doing inspections around the world, because whether it's an office with on the ground people living in those countries or sending inspectors over, it's hugely more expensive. But it's a requirement both to ensure safety and quality, but also of the law that, for example, FDA has to inspect a facility before it can approve a product, either an innovator drug or a generic. One of the interesting things is that US FDA is not alone in terms of the challenge of doing inspections in China and other places, and so we are actually starting to work with not just our counterparts in China, but with other regulatory authorities about how can we divide up the workplace and share information and workload so that we can do more with less and, again, ensure the American public that the products that they're using that are coming in whole or in part from China or other countries around the world are safe and of the quality that meets our standards. So it's an ongoing working relationship and an evolving practice in terms of the FDA sort of presence on a global basis.
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, thank you very much. Thank you for your insights. My name is Lydia Wernicke, coming from the University of Freiburg, a chair of public international law, and I'm a member of the German Ethics Council. I came from Germany last August, and I was a little bit puzzled when I read the newspapers in regard to the, well, I think one of the major health problems in the US, which seems to be drug addiction and the death because of, yeah, drug addiction. Mm-hmm. And I learned that there seems to be a link between the prescription of certain painkillers and drug addiction and the deaths caused by the drug addiction. And I wanted to know whether FDA has some further action on this, and what's your opinion on this? Because what was striking or astonishing in a way as well was after my husband got a tooth extraction, he got this painkiller. He didn't need it, he didn't ask for it, but he got the prescription. It was 4 weeks ago, so there doesn't seem to be huge limits.
Well, it's really an important problem. It's a huge and growing public health concern in this country. Prescription opiate addiction and heroin addiction leading to preventable deaths and preventable morbidity as well. And some of you may have seen a recent article showing that, in fact, longevity for, I think it's like 24 to 44 or something, particularly, I think, in white males, but it may, I don't remember for sure, is actually dropping off. And it's felt to reflect this growing problem. FDA does have some important roles to play, but I think some of the most powerful answers come from really drilling down into medical care practices in terms of prescribing. And the kind of thing you say worries me a lot. My 17-year-old daughter went for a consultation about having her wisdom tooth extracted, and she left with a prescription for Percocet. She never went back to that orthodontic surgeon, and she never filled the prescription, but I was amazed. But FDA has been trying to really introduce the notion of abuse deterrent formulations, which is not a magic bullet, because the abuse deterrent formulations are not that adequate, but they at least do reduce the attractiveness of opiate drugs for abuse, and has put out guidance and worked with industry to try to move these products towards abuse deterrent formulations. Also trying to help develop both new, better treatments for opiate and heroin addiction, which has been, I think, a gap in overall medical care, but also trying to advance new pain treatments that are not opiate-based, because for chronic disease in particular, opiates have been overused, and they may, in fact, for some people, be the only available treatment for debilitating pain. But very often, opiates are not the best treatment strategy, but they might be the easiest treatment strategy. And we need to really better refine medical practice, and I think we need new treatments for different types of pain that are non-addictive. In addition, when I was there, we worked with certain companies to develop naloxone, which can reverse an opiate overdose, into formulations that could be used in the community, because naloxone is a well-known, safe and effective drug that is administered in clinical settings to reverse an opiate overdose, and it works amazingly. But you often need that intervention in a very different setting than the clinical setting, and by the time you get the person into the hospital emergency room, they may have been lost. So an auto-injector, naloxone, was developed, and I think FDA may have also fairly recently approved, after I left, a nasal spray. But that offers the opportunity for both adjunct medical providers, EMS and others, to provide life-saving medical care, and also families and friends to be able to treat an opiate overdose and save lives. So I view that as a very important contribution by the FDA as well.
You, sir?
Thank you in advance for fielding questions. My name is Brian Schick, and I'm a medical device industry professional. Earlier, you talked about half of medical devices being manufactured outside the U.S. Another growing trend is the use of registered device manufacturers for them to use outsourced engineering services who aren't registered with the FDA to help in the development of the design history file. And so I was wondering what the FDA's interest was in these types of companies, and perhaps your opinion on the level or limits in responsibility or liability for these companies.
Now, I'm not quite sure what these companies are. They're outsourcing certain components of the medical device
development? So if you're in the development of the design history or remediation of the design history file, a registered device manufacturer would contract to assist in the remediation, perhaps, of those files. And so they would help kind of ghostwrite some of those documents, and then they would still go through the QMS of that registered manufacturer.
You know, again, I apologize, this isn't an area that I have, you know, any real expertise on. I would say that I think that whoever does the studies, whoever puts together the information, whoever manufactures the device, at the end of the day, the package that comes to the FDA has to have all of the information there. It has to be clear who's been responsible for what, and it has to meet the standards for safety, efficacy, quality, and performance.
I would agree with that.
Thank you.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Thank you so much for coming today. My name is Matt Wellington. I work with the US Public Interest Research Group on their program to stop the routine use of antibiotics on livestock and poultry for both disease prevention and growth promotion. So the FDA has made steps in the right direction on parts of this issue, which is fantastic. My question is, what kind of challenges did you face when it came to regulating the issue kind of in the big picture when it comes to all of the different players at the table with industry and different agencies as well?
Well, this is a really important issue in terms of the global challenge of antimicrobial resistance and the concern that many antibiotics are increasingly ineffective at treating important human and animal disease because of inappropriate use in many instances, and the fact that microbes evolve in response to exposure to antibiotics. And one important component of the development of antimicrobial resistance and the overuse of antibiotics is in animal production, and in particular for growth promotion. This was one of those interesting issues where, before I went to the FDA in another life, I actually wrote a report calling on the FDA to take more aggressive action in this area. So when I was at the FDA, I felt some accountability to actually work on this problem. And it was one that had thwarted the FDA for many years. You may or may not recall that when Don Kennedy was FDA commissioner back in the Carter administration, he had tried to work on this issue and had been thwarted in those efforts. He was really before the curve. He felt that this was a potential concern and wanted to address it. Over the time, the reality has really set in, and it's now an urgent problem needing to be addressed. But you know, there are many different stakeholders in this, and a lot of concern over the years from industry about disrupting patterns of animal husbandry and production. But it was clear that action had to be taken. It was also clear that the public, consumers, wanted action taken in terms of their own health and recognition of the problem of antimicrobial resistance. But I think it was more also that they just didn't want to be exposed to unnecessary antibiotics. But some things came together that enabled this to move forward. During my tenure, and I was very pleased that we made real progress at essentially what will be, it's being implemented now, but a functional ban on the use of critical antimicrobials for growth promotion purposes. There still is work to be done about bringing antibiotics in animal feed under the purview of veterinarians, which it hasn't previously been, in order to ensure more responsible stewardship. Tracking use in a way that's more transparent and informative and accountable, and also looking at some issues in the use of antibiotics for prevention purposes, which are harder to sort of define, you know, what is appropriate and what might be a slippery slope towards, you know, more broader use. So I think that's the next agenda for the FDA to work on.
Yeah, absolutely. Quick follow-up.
Hard stop at two.
Okay, absolutely. Thank you so much.
Hi there. My name is Tara McManus. I just finished my undergrad, and I would like to follow up a little bit on what you were talking about, the prescription opiate addiction problem, and curious to hear your thoughts or what the FDA is doing or not doing on modifying the scheduling of drugs. You know, marijuana is listed as Schedule 1, highly addictive drugs with no medical use, and then it's above Vicodin, Coke, Oxy, all of these opiates that are causing the increase of deaths in young people. So I'm just curious to hear, you know, what the FDA is doing about this issue.
Well, I think you probably know that the DEA establishes the schedule with input from the FDA, and I believe there is a process currently underway looking at the scheduling of marijuana. You know, certainly FDA has been a big advocate for more research, especially now when many states have actually implemented medical marijuana programs. There's a lot that we need to really study about medical marijuana and how it should be used, what conditions it benefits and which it doesn't. And you know, I think that most people would agree that the Schedule I designation has made it much harder to do important medical research. There's a lot of other factors that go into determining the scheduling. It's a fairly complex, well-established in law process, but I believe that that is a process that's underway, but I obviously can't comment on what was happening internally while I was there. There was an effort, as you probably know, to upschedule a class of opiate drugs because of concern about excessive prescribing that was facilitated by its scheduling, and that it met criteria for more oversight in the scheduling and prescription framework.
Thank you. I'm curious if you could speak to FDA's capacity to deal with cybersecurity issues with medical devices. You talked about repositioning FDA for a modern era, and that's a real thing now.
Yeah,
so
well,
can you speak to that?
Everyone is grappling with cybersecurity, and FDA faced it in a number of arenas. For one thing, you know, again, to my astonishment when I got there, you know, every day there were attempted penetrations of the FDA computer systems, both corporate and from other nations, because FDA sits on a rich database. You're really speaking to the issue of the security of software that underlies medical devices, and that is a real concern. It was in Homeland on TV as an issue, but it's also a real world concern, and something that we have tried to work with, you know, an array of external experts, as well as bring in expertise within FDA, and it is you know, part of the discussions around software-based medical devices. You want to make sure that they work, number one, that the software, you know, actually is good in that way, but you also want to have safeguards against intrusion, so to speak. So it's an area of focus and activity, but it's not one where, you know, anyone has all the answers.
I think we have one last question.
Thank you so much. I'm an animal welfare advocate. My name is Gail Williams, and I'd like to return to meat and potatoes and the relationship between USDA and the FDA with regard to regulating meat and poultry. Some people consider that the USDA especially is inadequate, and the relationship between the two agencies is quite confusing. Would it be possible for you to describe the ideal regulatory environment if you were to pass such a law in Congress? How would you arrange it so that our meat, dairy, and poultry was safe and food poisoning free? Thank you.
Well, you know, again, that's the kind of question that is very hard to address in the time frame that we have, but I think it is clear that our current system reflects sort of accretions over time and history, but not what necessarily is either most efficient or in the best interest of the public. You may be aware that FDA regulates the majority of the food supply, but USDA regulates meat, poultry, processed eggs, and soon catfish. FDA, we would whine at FDA that we regulated 80% of the food supply and got 20% of the funding. USDA has a different model, which has inspectors present at all times, but concerns, you know, the question about conflict of interest was raised earlier. Well, there are concerns about, you know, is that the right relationship? If the person is always there, you could argue it might be more effective because they can observe problems, but others are concerned that it's a very expensive system and it, you know, perhaps creates an environment where you're less likely to come in with clear eyes to identify problems. But I think what should happen, and it's been the topic of discussion for a long time, is that there should be a process. It's not going to happen overnight, but where you really look at these issues and move there. You know, you can't just merge. There was a proposal to just carve out pieces of FDA and pieces of USDA and put them together into one food safety agency. You can make an argument that a single food safety agency might have benefits, but it would have to be done in a way that would really rationalize the laws and the requirements around inspection and other oversight. I do think that the Food Safety Modernization Act sort of provides some framework for for what a modern food safety system would look like, and I think there's a lot to be learned there. Certainly it brought FDA onto farms and into that world more in terms of understanding the issues and the challenges. I think, you know, that this next era may be the time when people will really, you know, sort of look at these issues in a more integrated way. But I don't have, you know, the answer about exactly what the system should look like. But I do think we've created a world that's more complicated than it needs to be. It's not quite as complicated in practice as it sounds like. I mean, everybody likes to say, oh, it's so ridiculous. FDA regulates cheese pizza and USDA regulates pepperoni pizza. I mean, technically, you know, there's a little truth to that, but I mean, the system works okay in practice, but it's not what we would want if we were starting from scratch.
Well, I think it's time to draw this to a close, unfortunately. Peggy, you've been incredibly candid and straightforward. You've dealt with everybody's issues, and I cannot thank you enough on behalf of the law school and the sponsors of the program. It's just wonderful to have you back at Harvard.
Thank you. Thank you.